It is my honor to present Dr. Donna Cozort.
Tonight, I'd like for you to accompany me on a journey going back in time 1,200 years, way back to early Ireland, 8th century Ireland. It was a time in Ireland when Christianity was very new, and most of the people still spoke to and prayed to a goddess, even some of the people who had become Christians. It was a time of dark forces, and there were many unknowns. And besides the dark forces, there was a danger of Viking raids, which threatened to pillage the land and kill the inhabitants and torture them. Also, at times, there was famine, and there were diseases that threatened to wipe out large segments of the population. Now, if we go back even further, perhaps 6,000 years, to around 4,000 BC, nature was a powerful force, and it was named a goddess, a personified female deity capable of responding to appeals with force or favor. Nature as female was like an unwritten ideology, a primal ether which sustained the tribe, a maternal body upon which the community lived. Goddess, or nature personified, played a major role in Ireland for thousands of years. In the Labor Gaba Aben, which is the book of the taking of Ireland, three names of goddesses are written: the goddess Eru, the goddess Bamba, and the goddess Fodia. These women in the mythology begged the invaders, who at the time were the Celts, that their name be imposed upon the land. And indeed, Ireland is named for the goddess Eru. Women who embodied the deity were seen as bounty, for they provided children to replenish the fruits of the earth, and also, over the years, women probably invented horticulture, weaving, pottery, and basic medicine. Women embodied nature, and nature was her gift. The hills were named for women, and the streams and the rivers were also her reflection. And at death, people of notoriety returned to the stone tomb. This is a view of a goddess site that I visited when I was in Ireland. You can see the circular site in the old ancient stones. Now, just keep in mind, this goes back maybe to 4,000 years. Last spring, I was privileged to go to Ireland and to travel over 1,200 miles from south to northern Ireland. I felt the intense energy of the goddess surrounding me with her power, and felt haunted by the legends of the demise of the feminine. Reflecting on the present, I felt deeply saddened by our present-day lack of beauty and grace, and also the balance and the love of nature that the goddess can bring. And I might say that there's still people who worship the goddess in Ireland. You can see from this holy well that's near that goddess site. Now, I say these things about the goddess not because I'm pagan or because I'm a feminist, but because I recognize the masculine and feminine that exist within each man or woman. So the goal is not to promote one sex or gender over the other, but rather to find the balance of the two. You see, it's only when there is a balance, the correct balance between the masculine and the feminine, that we are whole. The masculine being the goal-directed, achievement-oriented side of ourselves, while the feminine being the relational aspect, the warm, nurturing relational aspect related to soul. So it's with a rich goddess cultural heritage that the faithful monks, who were the artists and scribes of the Book of Kells, worked, and what great artists they were. Not only in conveying the story of the Coptic Gospels of the Bible, but also, perhaps though inadvertently, also presenting the rich cultural heritage of their past ancestry. Now, for many years, the only way you could see any of the Book of Kells was you'd have to go to Ireland, to Dublin, and to Trinity College, and you could stand in a long line, and this is still true today, and then you'd only see one page per day, and it would take you about a year to see the whole book. So fortunately, we have some copies today, and you're seeing some of those as we go along. This, by the way, is a hawthorn tree, and it was thought that the fairies existed in the hawthorn trees of Ireland. That is one of the tombs of the goddess. And in just a few minutes, I'm going to show you myself going through that tomb. It is my thesis that in painting and decorating the Book of Kells, that the monks presented much more than illuminated script and beautiful icons for the faithful, but that they also presented elements of their rich goddess and cultural heritage in order to preserve a reverence for nature and also a feminine-masculine balance, which was being threatened by the increasingly patriarchal church in Rome. Now, the church in Ireland, first of all, was cut off from Rome because of, first of all, the geography, but also on the warring Gauls, which was Germany and Ireland, Italy. And so they traveled a great deal, and they traveled around Spain and went through the Mediterranean. And so they were influenced by the Desert Fathers. And so they adopted the Eastern Orthodox Church in their... not only in the dates, they had different dates, like for Easter and for New Year's, and they also had a different clerical tonsure. Now, you still may be wondering, just what is the Book of Kells all about, and what's all the fascination? I ask this myself until I begin to delve into the wonder. As one author said, it's difficult to write about the Book of Kells without resorting to hyperbole, but I think one of the best writings or descriptions comes from a 13th century historian, Garibaldus Gambrensis, and so I quote, "The Book of Kells contains the concordances of the four Gospels according to Saint Jerome, with almost as many drawings as pages, and all of them in marvelous colors. Here you can look upon the faces of the divine majesty drawn in a miraculous way. Here too upon the mystical representations of the evangelist, now having six, now four, and now two wings. Here you will see the eagle, there the calf, here the face of a man, there that of the lion." You're going to see those again. Those are the symbols of the four apostles. "And there are almost innumerable other drawings. If you look at them carelessly and casually, you're likely to think they're just dabs of paint rather than careful compositions. You will see nothing subtle where everything is subtle. But if you take the trouble to look very closely and penetrate with your eyes to the secrets of the artistry, you'll notice such intricacies, so delicate and subtle, so close together and well knitted, so involved and bound together, and so fresh still in their colorings, that you will not hesitate to declare that all these things must have been the result of the work not of men, but of angels." Now, when Tom Keener asked me to come here and talk to you about the symbolism of the Book of Kells, I had no idea what journey I was bound for. Not only have I journeyed to Ireland and seen the Book of Kells myself, but I've also tromped all over Ireland through all of the early Christian and pagan sites, as well as to delve through the volumes of Carl Jung, the works of James Hillman, June Singer, and Anne Ulanoff. And also, I looked at the books in mythology and spirituality of the Irish, including the Celts, as well as the Druids, to mention a few. I've spoken to many people, a priest friend. I spoke to one of my Irish colleagues, who's also a Jungian analyst from Dublin, and other analysts, psychologists, friends, and interested parties, and I still feel like there's so much more to learn if I just had another lifetime. After studying and then actually seeing the book, I realized that it carries a power that transcends the rational mind. I was moved in a way that I hadn't expected. Having had a second day in Dublin, I was compelled to go back and look at the book again, just to see if I could absorb some of the Newman, some of the power of this book. I really can't explain it, but the few pages I saw spoke to me in a way, and I felt a connection with the culture that I hadn't really considered before. This gave me a sense of community and a feeling of humanity with all ages, all men, and all the world. And I realized that we truly are all one. I felt and experienced a sense of refreshment, renewal, and peace. Now, while traveling with my guide in Northern Ireland, I was taken to a cemetery. But first, I'll show you the inside of this tomb. I was able to go inside the tomb, and these are some of the hieroglyphics. Pictures that I took, and here you can see me inside the tomb. Some of the swirls. This is the icon of Christ's arrest. Of course, you know the Virgin was before. And some of these are blown up pictures of just the minute details in the pictures. These are the symbols of the four apostles that I spoke about. A few more of the details, so you can just see. You know, they were so small that they think now that children, 8 to 10-year-old children, were employed to draw in the minute details because they are so difficult to see, and only children that age can see that well. This is Trinity College Library. The Book of Kells is at this library, housed in this library. And it's behind glass, kind of like our Constitution. You can't really get to it. Okay. While traveling with my guide in Northern Ireland, I was taken to an old cemetery in back of an old chapel that's still in use today. Behind the well-manicured graves were these old, unkept stones, weather-beaten, worn down, kind of leaning about like spirits of another world. Among them was this figure of Janus, the god of the crossroads. Two-faced god of the crossroads, because he looks both onto the world of the profane as well as into the world of the sacred. This figure provides an excellent metaphor for the Book of Kells, and also, I think, for my presentation tonight. This you can't see very well, but that's the back of that figure. My plan is to tell you briefly what is known of the history and development of the Book of Kells, discuss its artistry and construction, view the decorative themes of some of the pages, and consider the levels of symbolism in one or two of the images of the gospel figure. Along the way, we can speculate about the motivation and the incentive of the monks of Kells. Now, the book has been attributed to St. Columcille, who traveled to the Scottish Isle of Iona in 561. Now, this was about the same time that St. Patrick was also traveling about, just to give you a little bit of perspective. He traveled with 12 companions and established a monastery in Iona, excuse me. Now, monastery communities were set up, it's interesting, in a very feminine way. They're circular, and part of that was for the protection of the community. But if you'll notice, there's no hierarchy. There were the monks in the center. Outside were some of the clerks and the people who took care of the church itself. And then in the outer circle were the townspeople. It is thought that the Book of Kells was started in Iona, Scotland. But due to Viking raids, the monks fled away with the Book of Kells to the town of Kells, which was in Ireland. And so the provenance of where it started is still controversial. But today it is pretty much accepted that most of the major work was done in Kells, Ireland. And it was completed around 800. The community of Kells, which today is considered the place of its major development, must have been rich and stable with a number of scribes and artists, and also a library to have produced such a book. Calfskin, known as vellum, was used to make the pages, and in its original state, the skins of around 185 calves were used from a herd of well over 1,200 in order to make the book. And it, it may have required more if they had less time. Quill pens or reeds were used, and the writing was of a brownish iron gall ink made of crushed oak apples and sulfate of iron. Also, lamp black or soot was used in some places. And scribes and artists used compasses, dividers, squares, rulers, and templates. And as I mentioned, today we think that the small, minute details were done by children 8 to 12 years old. Paint brushes were fine fur, and colors of paints came from all over. It's even thought that perhaps some of the blues came from Afghanistan, because there is a place there in Afghanistan that was known in the Middle Ages for this paint. But some of the sources of the paint have still not been discovered, because most of them were organic. And the year 800 is a compromise date of the making of the book, so it's not really certain, nor is it certain how long the scribes worked. But we know that artisans who've tried to produce similar pictures estimate that it took at least 1 month for one of the icons to be painted, and perhaps more for pictures or print like the Cairo that Tom was talking about. Of course, it depended on the number of scribes and artisans who were working. It's thought that at least 4 major artists produced the book, and at least 4 major scribes completed the manuscript, and sometimes artists might have been scribes and vice versa. The book didn't come through the centuries without changes, and church records reveal that in 1007, it was stolen and recovered after 2 months and 20 nights covered with sod. The stone church where it was housed survived the transition from monastic to episcopal control, but not the Cromwellian period, when it was fit only for stabling horses. So it was hidden away for a long time. But the governor of Kells in 1653, Charles Lampert, sent it to Dublin, and it later made its way to Trinity College, where it is today. Some blank pages were used for some of the businesses of the Kell Monastery in the 11th century, so we have a little bit of history from that. In the 19th century, the pages, unfortunately, were severely cropped by an editor, and so the book, a lot of information was lost, and really they did more damage than any of the stealing away and those kind of things, except that some of the pages have been lost. But the pages themselves are very small, only a little bit, about 8 to 12 inches in size. At present, there are 340 folios, but some 30 have been lost. For example, the icons of Mark and Luke have been lost. Since the decorated pages were separated from those of the print, they were easily lost. There remain many questions as to the layers of meaning of the many images, such as the zoomorphic figures, which I think you saw in the early, and the swirls throughout the books. And usually you can see these in the sort of like in the frames of the book. Benedict of Anian described the complexity of the decoration as mirroring the verbal virtuosity of the Irish, which is meditative and elusive. All the uncertainties have only served to increase the fascination of the book, which for over 1,200 years has remained an enigma. Now, Carl Jung theorized that we are all influenced by invisible archetypes that shape our behavior and influence our inner world. Discovering and working with these archetypes can open us up to these powerful forces of transformation. And I'm going to give you a real life example from my work. But first, I want to explain to you what analysts like myself and Carl Jung mean by symbols. Perhaps the American flag is a symbol for you, as it is for me. When you see it, and especially in the playing of the national anthem, you're reminded of freedom and all the values that we hold dear. And maybe you're incensed, as I am, when people talk or gawk during these times. For them, perhaps it's just a sign. But for you, because it has deep meaning, it's a symbol. And that's the difference between a symbol and sign. Now, you may be wondering why psychoanalysts like myself are interested in symbols. But we're especially interested in symbols because they're the language of dreams, the unconscious, and the archetypes. Also, we believe and have experienced the power of the archetypes for transformation and meaning in life. And healing is the goal of analysis. And for me, healing is my calling, my vocation, and my quest. Carl Jung, after studying thousands of dreams and reading and studying the literature of different cultures, concluded that we all experience symbols that go much deeper than our personal experiences. Certainly, we have symbols such as the flag that we're well aware of, but there are other symbols that we have inherited from our primordial ancestry, which can sometimes elicit even more impact and more energy than the ones we can easily recall. This remote material makes up the myths and stories of our particular culture, and their underlying themes are archetypal. Archetypes are powerful, universal themes or potentials. Potentials of becoming, becoming all that we can become. They belong to all people and all cultures. Myths and their understanding, which are based on archetypes, are most important because they carry important spiritual truths and powerful energy, which connect all people of all times. However, they very often elude our rational mind. Now, let me give you a real-life example of the symbolic power of the archetype. This is the archetype of Job, which is basically a universal theme of God against man. It led to the healing of my patient Mary, who is a Navy nurse who suffered with post-traumatic stress syndrome from her war experience in Vietnam. If you recall the story of Job, Job was severely tested by God, and in essence, God seemed to turn his back on Job. This archetype brought great energy and hope and final healing to Mary, who also felt like God had turned his back on her. For 6 long years, she had just wanted to die. It was only when I read her something about the archetype of Job that she began to spark alive again. She began to read everything she could, not only from the book in the Bible, but also everything she could read about Job and anything that had been written about him. She brought in things to me to read, and her healing began. Mary was able to realize that God had been with her throughout her long journey. This renewed her faith and reoriented her to soul and brought healing. Early in his practice, Carl Jung realized that most people in what he called the second half of life were struggling with religious issues, whether they thought themselves to be religious or not. Now, he was not talking about any particular creed or denomination, but rather for the search for meaning. He called this the religious function. He saw a religious function operating within the mind of all individuals, which he meant was a drive for a meaningful relationship with the personal to the transpersonal source of power. Now, I'm giving you all this background because I think this was what was happening with those monks of Kells. Back in their little cells, maybe for a whole month, painting one icon, if you can only imagine. You know that, just like the alchemist, which Jung writes about in some of his work, something spiritual was happening. If you've ever done any portrait painting, as I have, I also took an icon painting class, you know that when you put in the eyes of those figures, they come alive. And so I wanted to talk to you about this because I think it's very relevant to what was going on with the monks of Kells. This drive for meaning manifests itself in the identification, the encountering, and even the production of images, sometimes in dreams, sometimes in synchronicities, sometimes in just images out in the real world. These make perceptible the symbolic meaning of experience. In particular, these images become symbols of something beyond, which articulate ultimate meaning and act as unifying symbols of the psychology of the individual. In my example, Job, in the biblical story of Job, became a symbol
for Mary, connecting her back to her religious heritage and thus to life and its meaning for her. Now, of course, different archetypes are activated in each one of us at different times in our lives. So an important question you may ask yourself is, what archetype am I living under at present? After her trauma, Mary, like Job, thought God had rejected her, but through reading and identifying with Job, she discovered he had been with her all along. Now, this is not a rational thing, but rather it's spiritual. The energy of the archetype fueled Mary's search for truth and ultimately to her healing. And for me, I think it was Carl Jung who said that transformation can only come in the patient if it comes in the analyst. And I can tell you that I was transformed by this experience. It was a beautiful experience and helped me realize that I had found my true calling in life. Now, the development of Western philosophy has succeeded in isolating the mind in its own sphere and severing it from its primordial oneness with the universe and with nature. The icons themselves, I believe, provided powerful symbols for the monks of Kells as well as for the early Christian followers. And I believe it was in efforts not only to connect with the spiritual and its significance, but also to preserve the balance of the spiritual to the physical world that the monks of Kells worked so fervently. As I've mentioned, the images were so small that children had to draw them in. Not only did the portraits of Christ and the apostles carry deep spiritual significance for the early Christians, but there is meaning in every small nuance, the color and the character, as well as all the added characters to the book. Whether it was animal, plant, human, or a combination. So I'm just showing you some of the blown up images from these tiny pages. And this is the temptation of Christ. Now, back at the time in the 8th century, these books were actually worshipped. And so these icons were actually seen literally as representative, and also they actually had the meaning. They really believed that they carried the numen of the apostles. They were also considered talisman for good luck. The meaning of the symbols became even more relevant. Now, there are numerous pagan sites which are found all over Ireland, and only recently have archaeological digs verified the myths and sagas that a rich goddess culture existed before Christianity. And what is so interesting is you probably know that a lot of our like Easter Bunny and the Christmas trees and things of that, that we've adopted some of the old pagan practices. Well, in Ireland, they took over not only the cemeteries and the places of worship and the festivals, but they also, the goddesses, became saints. So this is Job. This is a Blake rendition of the trials of Job. Now, this is an old fire temple of the goddess Brigid, who became Saint Bridget. And this fire temple, as you see, was restored in 1988, and it's behind a church that is now in use today. And it's in a cemetery, so you can see there that it's been restored. And Saint Bridget was the saint that was worn on the breastplate of Saint Patrick. So it's another view of the fire temple. Now, there's no doubt that foremost in the minds of the monks of Kells was the glorification and documentation of Christ's life and message on earth, and the book reflects the principal moments of Christ's life. I've mentioned, we see his birth with Mary, his teachings, the temptation, and his arrest. And I've mentioned that the images were important because they provided, according to Pope Gregory the Great, a living reading of the Lord's story for those who cannot read. It was also important that the icons should impress. So they were usually kept on the high altar and they were gilded, both to honor to Christ, but also to impress the congregants. No matter that there are ineligible lines, and there's a remarkable degree of inaccuracy, and the book is incomplete. But they were thought to be used by monks who knew the scriptures anyway, so that was okay. The decorative plan appears to have been that each gospel is first introduced by a page of evangelist symbols. Okay, we're not quite ready to go there. A portrait page, and then an elaboration of the opening words or letters. As mentioned earlier, some of the icons were lost, such as those of Mark and Luke. Now, one of the things that I discovered when I was going to school in Switzerland, one of my friends invited me to go to a celebration of the ancient calendar for New Year. And that friend, Oscar Meyer was his name, was a Swiss friend of mine, and he had nothing to do with a hot dog. So we went up into the Appenzell, and the Appenzell is the oldest and probably the most backward canton of Switzerland, so they still use this old Eastern Orthodox calendar for some of their celebrations. So here you see, these were considered the civilized, the men, and they didn't let the women do this at all. So these are the men, and at the back you can see one woman. I'll get it better. There's the woman, okay, but that's a man dressed as a woman. So what they did was they pranced around the village, and the village had strategically located campfires. And you can see the snow piled up. It was cold. It was January in Switzerland. Fortunately, it was not snowing that night, but it was very cold. And they would circle the campfire, and particularly the primitives. Now, that's a picture of me and my friend. That was 20 years ago, so these are the primitives. The primitives would circle the campfire, and then they would shake those bells and chant. And the wind whistling through those reeds gave you a real eerie feeling. And I realized that we were at an old pagan goddess fertility rite. The people of the village had no idea what it was. There you can see one of the mustaches of the supposed woman, and those were the primitives. So I thought I would share that because I know that the monks from Ireland went all over Europe and started monasteries. So it's my hypothesis that they started a monastery in the Appenzell. I haven't verified that, but I plan to. It's a contrast with the Romanesque church. It's a portrait of Christ. These are the symbols, the ox, the lion, the eagle, and the man of the four apostles. Some of the Celtic swirls. It's blown way, way up just so you can see it. Some of the print. That is Matthew. And here we have the Virgin. The first icon I want to discuss in a little more detail is the Virgin and Child. As Tom said, it's supposedly, we think that it's the oldest extant, and we looked that word up for you, which means it has lasted over the years, image of the Virgin Mary in Western manuscript. It's interesting that according to researcher Margaret McCurtain, the figure of Mary is missing from the mythology of the early Celtic Christians. Of course, the mythology was going on, but it wasn't really recorded until later. Perhaps Mary as virgin was too ideal and non-human to become a source of support. The Irish were known to be very earthy, basic people with none of the fine, refined intricacies of finer society. Both men and women were open with their love and their conflicts. Fights among same sex and opposite sex were common and often initiated and won by women. Mary's saintly virginity hardly seemed approachable to women, such as those who enjoyed a prominent role in the early church. The Irish had a strong heritage of the land, as personified as woman and co-equal with it. As Prosaeus McKenna says, she cannot die except if the realm dies or is destroyed. So the realm was named for women. The place of women in these myths played out in their prominent roles not only within the early Christian church in Ireland, but in Irish society in general. Now, the Eastern Orthodox was much more open to the feminine than the Roman church in Rome, which really didn't come into Ireland until about the 12th century. That's when they actually adopted the Roman Episcopal hierarchy. With the Pope on down, or the Archbishop on down, whichever religion we're talking about. Just to review just a bit, the Celts came from the northern tribes coming mostly from Scandinavia to Spain, Britain, and Ireland during the 4th and the 3rd centuries B.C. So that was their height. So they were before this time, which is the 8th century A.D. The term Celtic art is used to describe some of the decorations of the Book of Kells, since the monks of the 7th to the 9th century drew from this older tradition. And I've showed you some of the Roman patterns, the animal ornamentation, the key patterns, the dots and interlacings, which were all assimilated in the artistic repertoire. Now, when you're facing this book, the Book of Kells, icon of the Virgin Mary and Child, Mary is just left a sinner. The Christ child on her lap balances her in that he is just right of the sinner, therefore completing a masculine-feminine balance. The two figures seem otherworldly, suggestive, I think, of the archetypal nature of their image. Mary wears a crimson robe of swirls, and we can stop right there. It would be very difficult today for you to find a picture of the Virgin Mary in anything but blue. It was Pope Gregory the Great who projected all of the Marys were one and projected Mary Magdalene as the sacred prostitute. And Barbara Harker, my friend who's visiting with us tonight, and I went to a workshop in Florence, and we went all through the churches and looked at all the images of Mary and Mary Magdalene. So all of the passion and the earthiness of women was projected on Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, lost all of her passion. She was put in a cold crimson robe, blue being sky and spiritual devotion and innocence. On her right shoulder, perhaps suggesting a quaternal form of the Godhead, is a diamond. There are tiny white clusters of three or four, which could represent an emerging Trinitarian to quaternium Godhead, which could lead to a masculine-feminine balance, unlike the more masculine trinity of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Jung believed that the Holy Ghost was feminine and that Mary's more recent promulgation to heaven by the Catholic Church concluded the balancing of the masculine feminine within the church. Again, remember the masculine and feminine exists within men and women. I'm talking about these as characteristics of the personality. White alone represents purity, but in the black-white symbolism, white is seen as masculine while black is feminine. It's a more earthy color. The robe, as I've mentioned, is of crimson. The attribute of Mars represents passion, sentiment, and the life-giving principle. Also, Mary's vestments are transparent to reveal lactating breasts, which emphasize her nurturing, life-giving, mature nature. You certainly won't see that today. It makes her much more approachable, I think. She's more alive, more real. And I think that may be why we have so many black Madonnas throughout Europe, because she's more approachable. And there's one in Ireland, by the way, which I visited in Dublin. The gold lining of the robe corresponds to the mystic aspect of the sun, which is also found in Mary's head covering, her throne chair, and her halo. And gold is a color both of the inner and outer frames surrounding the picture. Some of these colors are a bit faded. Mary's halo contains three golden crosses, symbols of the crucifixion, as well as salvation and blessing. There's an overlap of angel wings, and these are lined in laurel, forming a halo of gold. Laurel was sacred to Apollo and expressive of victory, not victory over external and visible consecration of an act, but rather it connotates a series of inner victories over negative or dissipative forces within. And of course, that's so true to Mary, who, of course, in becoming the mother of Christ, had to set aside, I'm sure, all of her worldly cares and really take on all that that role signified. At the top of the back of Mary's throne chair is the head of a lion. The lion is the emblem of St. Mark, but it's also one of the symbols of Christ. And so it represents the sun and the masculinity and earthly virility, which balances the feminine image of Mary. It appears to be eating two black serpents, and I don't know if you can see this very well in the picture, but the snakes appear as symbols of evil in this particular situation. Now, snakes also carry the energy of life, their life energy, and because they shed their skins, they also represent transformation. So it depends on the context. And that's one of the difficulties in interpreting the symbols, is it really sometimes depends on the context, but it also depends on what the symbols are for the monks who painted them. So we can't really get into their minds. We can only give you an approximation of what the symbols really stood for. Because as I've said, a symbol is something much deeper than just a sign. It really has some deep spiritual meaning for the congregant, or the monk in this case. The two inner frames are the soft color of rose, which also is the color of the top of the angel's wings. Rose is associated with red, the color of passion, but also of woundedness. Mary is surrounded by four angels, the top two alternating in color from the lower two. Red on the top left and black on the right, and black on the lower left and red on the right. Angels represent the ascending and descending from heaven, and so they represent the connection between the phenomenological world and the spiritual world. They also have a protective and sublime connotation. We've seen that red is a color of passion, but also it's associated with blood, wounds, and death. Black may be symbolic of the fertilized land within and its mineral life, but it's more likely associated with debilitation and life in the animal life. Red and black seem to reflect the chthonic vegetative aspects of the Great Mother, and of also of the biblical story of Christ. Again, there seems to be a balance between life and death, with the four angels reflective of these two important archetypes. The colors also reflect those used by the ancient alchemists. Now, it was Carl Jung who studied the alchemists during the Middle Ages, and you probably know something about them because they supposedly were trying to develop gold. Well, I think just as the monks, they also were on a spiritual journey, and it was Carl Jung who, in reading their old manuscripts, discovered this. And perhaps this was their spiritual journey because they lived during the Inquisition. And so it's thought that perhaps that's how they covered up some of their practices, so who thought very much about these mad scientists who were trying to create gold. Prime matter corresponded to black. Black pertaining to fermentation, putrefaction, occultation, and penitence. Mercury, or white, to that of illumination, ascension, revelation, and pardon. Red, the culmination of the production of the stone. Red pertained to suffering, sublimation, and love. And gold, which was the final opus, and that was a state of glory. The state of finding the spiritual truth. There are matching insets on either side of Mary, which are adorned with interlacings of green, which betokens the fertility of the fields, sympathy, and adaptability. and white, symbolic of purity, is balanced by black fecundity and sanguineous red. There are two profiles on each side, the second of which is upside down. The meaning of the hangman of the tarot deck to these Kells figures appears relevant to Mary's lives. The hangman stands for restriction, restraint, and stasis, all aspects of the feminine nature of nurturing, waiting, and holding. The hangman also reflects sacrificing and suffering, two aspects of both Mary and Christ's life. Now, all of these characteristics are important to the individuation process. And that was the process Carl Jung talked about of becoming whole, of developing all aspects of the personality. Of course, any association between early Christianity and the Tarot must be archetypal, for the cards didn't enter Europe until the 18th century from Arabia, long after the 6th to 8th century of the Book of Kells. The mixing of vegetative and animalistic, especially serpentine, along with the human characteristics, is evident both in the insets and in the largest frame around Mary and Child. Irish artists learned about Germanic style ornamentation from their Anglo-Saxon neighbors in Britain, adapting the motifs to native Irish taste. Mediterranean art was brought to Ireland and assimilated through trade as well as from the traveling monks. Animals with scroll joints, such as those found in the Book of Kells, have been found on stone carvings of the Picts, ancient inhabitants of Scotland. And here you can see that this is some of the metalwork, and you can see the similarity in some of the pottery. All of the similarities reflect a common archetypal basis. John Hill, who is my analyst friend from Ireland, from Dublin, in his essay, Archetypes of the Irish Soul, talks about Eileen and Brinkley Reeve's finding about other world voyages in which the world as we know it becomes unraveled into separated aspects. The forgotten world of possibilities remained for the Druids a cherished doctrine of the afterlife. Hill reminds us that this belief is also important. It's a common Indo-European doctrine found in the Tibetan Book of the Dead and in other writings which guide the soul to its final voyage beyond the boundaries of life and death. The significance of this to the Druid was that all combinations were possible and necessary prior to the final resting of the soul. This seems very close to the individuation process and our own development, and it's reflected, I think, in the Book of Kells. Now, the Christ child, appears as a little man, again, reflecting his timelessness, I think. He's dressed in green, a very life-giving color robe. His lower vestments are gold, again associated with the mystic aspects of the sun, as well as his princely or kingly nature. Both characters, you notice, are shoeless, which supports their groundedness in the earth and also humility and grace. So I'm going to run through these images right here just one more time to get to the image of Saint John. Those are the scroll joints you can see there. Okay. The next icon I'd like to talk about is the image of Saint John. Now, you notice that it's one of the most striking figures, I think, of the entire book. It's very beautiful. And his head is completely encircled by a double ring halo. And I found out when I was in Dublin and in Trinity University that this halo in the back of his head is thought to hold a plan of the Holy Sepulchre, or tomb of Christ in Jerusalem, and the circular church over it. And this was pointed out by one of the pilgrims in the 7th century who was traveling through Iona, Scotland, on his way back from the Holy Land. In John's right hand is a quill pen representing his role as the author of his gospel. As is the cow horn ink pot, it is right foot. There's another figure at the center of the outer edges with feet and hands on either side and a head at the top. Unfortunately, it was partially disfigured because of the binder's knife that I mentioned in the 19th century, which did so much damage. So it's very difficult. There's also serious abrasions to one of the hands that held a bifurcated flowering rod. So the identification of the figure on the outside is problematic. And although many thought that it was the head of God, a more recent scholar has suggested that it was the head of the risen Lord, or Christ. There are four crosses placed around John at head, feet, and two sides, and each is framed by a blue background. The gold crosses are all embellished with the same geometric Celtic squirrels and outlined in gold. The four corners of the inner frame are outlined in gold and contain circular and triangular inlays with gold interlacings and a floral-like center. I mentioned that the evangelist symbols, there are three pages of those, and these symbols actually originated in the prophecies of Ezekiel in the Bible and the Apocrypha, which describe winged creatures with four figures of a man, a lion, a calf, and an eagle. These became associated with the evangelists, as I've mentioned, but St. Gregory explained the symbols as also the four stages of Christ's life: a man in his life, a calf in his death, a lion in his resurrection, and an eagle in ascending into heaven. Each of the four figures is accompanied by one or more other figures to stress the unity of the Gospels. These figures are found in the text in diverse forms. This is interesting. For example, the eagle in this particular picture holds his gospel with a human hand. And there is an eagle much like the one specifically representing John in the Book of Armand, which is another book that was made a little bit later than the Book of Kells. The eagle represents the spirit of the Son and thus the Father principle, but also the spiritual principle in general, and the heroic nobility and power in war. It, like angels, can be a messenger from heaven and represents the power to rise and destroy base forces. It was also known as the storm bird of Jupiter. Now, if we visit the icon or look at the icon of St. John from this Book of Kells, we can see how its structure conforms to Jung's characteristics of mandalas. There's a circle in the center surrounding the spherical head of John, which is the center focal point. The circle is a wheel and decorated with eight-pointed floral patterns on three equidistant points around the circle, while both the inner and outer circle are elaborately decorated with interweaving and geometric designs. There are 12 points, including the head of John, which includes the 12 points. There's an energy about the head of John which might suggest movement. The circle contains snakes laced within the outer circle. The outer edge is rectangular, a kind of squaring of the circle. Now, there's also an eight-circle cross in the Book of Kells that Tom was asking me about. And I'll show you a picture at the end of it. But the squaring of the circle, which is shown in the eight-circle cross, is thought to be the terrestrial. The square is the terrestrial leading to the circle, which is the celestial. So that was also the balance of the sacred and the profane. A courtyard motif might be imagined within the square surrounding John. There are two eyes of the saints. There are tetradic figures of crosses and geometric corners squared on two sides with elaborate interlaced figures at either corner of the outer rectangle. The central figure of John is pentatric, including two hands, two feet, and one head. In the outer perimeter, the head and hands on either side and feet in the center are repeated. The other pictures of Christ, Mary, and Saint Matthew follow a similar structure with some variations in the type of figures included. so we can see how closely the icons of the Book of Kells follows Jung's physical characteristic of mindfulness. But more important is the psychological and spiritual significance that these archetypal images have for the faithful. Jung describes mandalas as expressing religious, numinous thoughts and ideas, or in their stead, philosophical ones. Most mandalas have an intuitive, and I'm quoting Jung here, an intuitive, irrational character, and through their symbolic content, they possess a magical significance, like icons, whose possible efficacy is never consciously felt. The magical significance of icons in the Book of Kells is much more likely to have been felt and recognized by the monks of Kells, who live much closer to the unconscious than the 19th and 20th century Carl Jung. Jung died in 1961, just to give you an idea of when he lived. Jung believed that the great question of his day was how to connect consciousness, which he described as our most recent acquisition, to unconsciousness, which he said is lagging behind, and certainly is lagging even further behind today. The monks of Kell, on the other hand, were intuitively attempting to preserve aspects of the irrational, of the unconscious, which were beginning to be eclipsed by the rational dogma of the Roman Church. For them, becoming whole almost seems to have gone in reverse in the sense of preserving what was much nearer to the surface than in the lives of the individuals in the 19th and 20th century Westerners of Jung's era. Though the goal of painting mandalas or icons varied between the monks and Jung, the process was similar in that the paintings were dimly sensed changes of a third eye going on in the background of the psyche, which produced ideograms of unconscious contents, which often were in opposition to one's conscious intention. Now, Jung went for a period of 10 years, Jung went on what I would call his odyssey. He went into the underworld and studied the unconscious to develop his theory. And it was during that time, toward the end, that he began painting mandalas. And he didn't really understand why he was painting mandalas at first, until he realized that they were all circling around a center. And so he realized that their basic premonition that there was a center of a personality, a kind of central point within the psyche to which everything is related, by which everything is arranged, and which is a source of energy. And Jung stated that the energy of the central point is manifested in an almost irresistible compulsion to become what one is. This central point, of course, he was talking about himself. He experienced this as he was painting these icons, and I'm going to show you, some of these mandalas, and I'm going to show you some of the mandalas that he painted. He called the central point the self, and he capitalized that word, and he described all other aspects of the psyche as circling around the center. The self gives each of us a sense of deeper meaning. It's an inner voice of wisdom which leads us to our full potential. This universal urge brings us to the final opus. This is from Tibet, one of the mandalas. These are some images from Man and His Symbols. This is from Notre Dame Cathedral, the Rose Window, another mandala, Sanskrit mandalas, sand painting mandala by a Native American. They're very universal. Now, this is very interesting. If you send sound waves through water, it forms a mandala, and that's what this is, an image of sound waves. So you can see that these are universal images. So this universal urge of becoming all that we can become brings us to the final opus, not only of each individual, but of each culture that has ever existed in all the world. It's the union which Joseph Campbell describes in discussing a police officer who reached out and saved the life of a man who was hanging by his fingernails, the suicidal man, knowing that he risked his life to save him. It's the same thing when a person pushes a child to safety, risking their own life. It's the realization of our commonness and a connection with all people of all cultures at all times, the anima mundi, or world soul. Human beings have a driving urge for completion and becoming what they truly are. It involves the relativization of the ego, a setting aside of the ego, and the embracing of all aspects of the personality, a coming home to all that is lost, disowned, discarded, and forgotten, all aspects of the personality. And just as it occurs on an ontogenic level within the individual, it also occurs on a phylogenetic level on the outside, which can lead to the connection of all races and all people in all times. This was a process I experienced at Trinity College when I visited and looked on the Book of Kells. It's the very same universal process that was operating within the psyches, I think, of the old alchemists in the Middle Ages, and even before with the 8th century monks of Kells, who in attempting to connect with all aspects of Christianity and life itself, brought us the Book of Kells, which for us is an everlasting legacy of wholeness. Thank you.
Any questions, comments, protests? This is the library. You can say what you want. Questions? People ask me, somebody asked me, why are you wearing a kilt? This is an Irish thing. I said, did you hear say it got started? Might have gotten started in Scotland.
Yes.
Questions, comments, protests? Don't be bashful. This is your time.
These are Carl Jung's
okay.
Paintings.
I have a question about the language. I mean, yeah, I'm sorry. I have a question about the language.
Of the Book of Kells?
Yeah.
It's in Latin.
Latin.
Uh-huh.
Thank you.
But if you look at it, it's very difficult to read because it's so ornate. I mean, even if you read Latin.
Questions, comments, protest? Okay, back there. I'm going to take your question, but let me see if I can get you on the way up so I don't have to come back. Here we go.
What's the best pub close to Trinity?
I'm sorry.
What's the best pub next to Trinity?
The best pub? Oh.
She said Temple Bar. Questions, comments?
By the way, the pub food is very good in Ireland.
By the way,
especially the fish and chips.
Anybody? Questions? Comments? Okay. I'll be while I'm over there, I was going to say that Dr. Cozort will be speaking to the International Conference of Union Analysts in Kyoto, delivering this paper. But you've heard it first at the Allen Public Library, where she has delivered it for the first time.
You mentioned that some of the iconography was, it looks pretty similar to some of the Eastern Orthodox icons, and also that the Celts came through Gibraltar.
They came around and they went up to, and they were influenced by the Desert Fathers, yes. And so they adopted, actually, the Eastern Orthodox Church.
I was wondering, did you find anything that would lead you to believe there was any connection with the art of North Africa?
The Egyptians, yes. I think so, the hieroglyphs, I think there's some similarity in the patterning. I do. I think part of it, maybe they picked up some of the pattern, but I think part of it was archetypal, too, in the symbolism.
Thank you.
Does that answer your question?
That was a good question.
Very good. Because the Desert Fathers, you know, they were from Egypt, so they were very influenced by them. And the Irish went all over. You know, like I said, they develop monasteries in Switzerland, for example. I know for sure that is. I just don't know for sure if the one in the canton that I visited was from the church in Kells. I have to find that out.
What she's trying to say is Celtic influence is everywhere. Questions? Oh, yes. Okay, good. Okay.
I'm sorry, I'm unfamiliar with the phrase Desert Fathers. Can you tell us more about that?
Well, the Desert Fathers they came out of Egypt, and they very much, you know, and this kind of gets into the controversy of the church. You know, the in the early church, because they were still warring, I mean, Ann Pagels talks about this, if you want to read about it. She talks about how in efforts to establish the Christian church, there were still people who were, and this is the Roman church I'm talking about now, they were threatened by the goddess worship or anybody who, particularly the Gnostics, threatened them because they felt that spirituality was an individual journey. And so in the Roman church, they, in order to develop the papacy and the hierarchy, they wanted to interpret the Bible to the congregants. So there was a big controversy in the church. But the Desert Fathers were over coming out of Egypt, and they advocated an individual journey. And so they were more pilgrims that would go into the desert, just like Christ went into the desert to find the Spirit individually. And so, you know, it was out of that tradition that the monks of Kells worked. And I think even being in a monastery is more of an individual tradition rather than the hierarchical tradition of the Roman Church, which was not really adopted until the 12th century in Ireland, because it was cut off because all of the warring that was going on in Germany and at the time, and France. My friend Father Ray, is Father Ray here? He's the one who gave me a little bit about the history of what was going on in Ireland at that time.
Hi, I read somewhere that the Book of Kells is one of the first manuscripts that had spaces between the words. Can you comment on that? Do you know?
No, I really don't know that. I know it's unusual in that beginning each page they elaborate on the first lettering, which is unusual, but I don't know about the spacing. I mean, I've not read that. Thank you. I'll try to look that up.
Okay, Steve's finally got a question. It's not a program without Steve asking a question.
Has the Book of Kells ever left Ireland? It seemed like there was one instance where it did, and it was slightly damaged or part of
it. It started in Iona, Scotland, which was an island in Scotland. And then it was taken, because of the Viking raids, it was taken to Kells. Now, during that time, as far as we know, it stayed in Ireland.
I'm talking about modern times.
No, not that I'm aware of. That's a good question.
I think there was a time, and I'd have to research it, but back in the 60s, they maybe take a page or two over to Australia, and it came back with a little tear in it, and they said they would never leave Ireland again, ever. So that's a story I read one time.
I mean, if you go see it, it looks like it's kind of in a tomb. It's covered up, sort of like our Constitution. I mean, it's like it's got a cover over it, so you can't, and it's in kind of a dark room, I guess, to preserve the color.
Okay, one more question.
This is a pragmatic question. How do they turn the pages day after day, year after year, without messing it up?
I have no idea. I'd love to have seen the turning of the pages, but I wasn't privy to that, so it's a good question, too.
One more question. Okay, in the back.
I know there is a copy of the Book of Kells in the library at Stephen F. Austin University, and at the university that's in Sherman, Texas, have copies of it. I have sat and drooled for hours.
You can buy a copy if you like, yeah.
Has anybody ever figured out what tools they used to paint with?
They used quill pens, And they also use fine fur, you know, that, you know, that's what I was talking about. They use quill pens, and they use, the ink was made of iron sulfate and oak, crushed oak apples, and they also use soot from lamps. And they made the brushes with quills too, and they used fur on them. So they used brushes probably similar to the ones we have today, but they use quill pens.